As a brief introduction to him, let me give a readout of a few achievements of his. He is the elected fellow of all three science academies of India, as well as of the Third World Academy of Sciences. He is currently the chairman of the Astrophysics Commission of the International Union for Pure and Applied Physics. He was also the president of the Cosmological Commission of the International Astronomical Union during 2009 to 2012. He was a SACLA Distinguished Astronomer in the Institute of Astronomy, Cambridge. He has been conferred several national and international awards, including the TWAS Prize in Physics, the Infosys Prize in Physical Sciences, the Millennium Medal, and the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award. His research work has won prizes several times from the Gravity Foundation of the USA. And in recognition of his achievements, the President of India has also awarded him the Padma Shri in 2007. So we are quite fortunate to have him here to give this talk. He has of course got this idea of bringing his research to you, and so for delivering a talk on cosmic history and mysteries, let me invite Professor Padmanabhan on stage. During several outings that he has, but most importantly during the Infosys Prize in Physical Sciences. So although this talk has been delivered at some other places, we are expecting a lot of new matter and some experiences of his. Just a quick reminder that we should switch off our mobile phones, please.
Thank you, Sameer, for a nice introduction. So, the topic of today's lecture is loosely titled as Cosmic History and Mystery, and I will cover both aspects of it. I find a large number of students, and obviously not all of you are doing cosmology for a living, so I thought I would start with a very reassuring slide, that cosmology is extremely simple. So, there is nothing to be scared about. This handsome guy out here, by cosmological standards, is quite handsome. What he is doing is one of the two things. He is either taking the structure of physical laws as we know today from the laboratory, and he is trying to understand from that the structure of the universe. So in some sense, he or she wants to explain the cosmos from known physical laws, from a fraction of a billionth of a second to about 14 billion years. Now, what is very heartening is that we have been very successful in that. We do understand the evolution of the universe from a fraction of a billionth of a second to about 14 billion years. So by any normal stretch of imagination, this is a very long time, and we should be very happy about that. And I will be spending some amount of time describing how we have achieved this. But what is really the fun part of cosmology is not this, but the reverse. You want to look at the structure of the universe before the 1 billionth of a second, and use that to test physical theories using cosmology. So this is the reverse direction which we want to go. But as I said, this is good enough for most people, and there's a huge amount of research area which comes under this, but I find this to be the real fun. Go into the unknown territory and use the structure of the universe to understand the structure of the physical laws. That is where the mysteries come from. The other part is the history. So I will start with the history first. For that, I have to first describe to you the structure of the physical laws and how they interface to the structure of the universe. So the first part of the talk is going to spend time on that one. Okay, so let us look at the structure of the physical laws. And there are different ways of introducing the kind of physical laws, the laws of physics, which we are familiar with today. One very simple way is to use what I call the cube of theoretical physics. So this, you just think of it as a cube with three axes. And the axes are labeled by fundamental constants. So here is one constant, which is the Newtonian constant G, which tells you the gravitational force between matter. Here is a constant which is essentially the speed of light. I have marked it as 1 by the speed of light, which tells you all about relativity and things like that. And there is another constant called the Planck constant, which tells you about quantum theory and the microscopic physics. So you can sort of arrange things in such a way that these three constants take value unity in some chosen set of units, which can always be done. And any other constant can be expressed in terms of these, as far as the numerical factors go. So if you look at this, by going around different faces and vertices of the cube, you can sample the laws of physics. So let me show you how it works. Let us start first by not worrying about either of these two axes and just go along this axis. If you do that, what you get is what is popularly known as the mechanics of Newton, Sir Isaac Newton. And that is pretty good in the sense that virtually everything which you can think of in physics in the macro world, from throwing of a ball up in the air to the motion of the planets in the solar system, is all ruled over by this. There are no surprises here. This is the standard textbook stuff. Suppose you go along this direction. That is where you first come across the first revolution in theoretical physics. And here is where the special theory of relativity, created by Einstein in 1905, resides at this point. So there are two things which I would like to stress for this purpose of this talk in special theory of relativity. One is something everybody knows, E equals mc squared. You may not know what M, E, C, E in it, but you know that E is equal to mc squared. Okay? So that is an equivalent between energy and mass, and several t-shirts. I'm sure there must be somebody here in the t-shirt. The other thing which is more important to physics is that he combined space and time and put it together in a single fabric which we call space-time. So just as you can move in space and move in time, and the motion in space affects spatial coordinate, the motion in time also has an intermingling of these two effects, and that is what special theory of relativity told you. So that is in this direction. Now let us go in this direction. This direction takes you to the world of quantum mechanics. The quantum mechanics rules over the micro world. All of physics of molecules, atoms, nuclear, elementary particles, all of them. And in fact, all of chemistry comes from quantum mechanics. There are again one important feature in quantum mechanics, namely what is known as uncertainty principle. Normally if I take again a ball and throw it up, at any given time you will assume that I will know where the ball is and how fast it is moving. Like if you have an airplane, you need to know where it is and how fast it is moving, otherwise it would be a disaster. But what quantum mechanics tells you is that in the micro world, when you are looking at very tiny particles, if you know the position and then you will not know its velocity and vice versa with arbitrary accuracy. There is a kind of a minimum uncertainty between these two, which is one of the key concepts which comes from quantum mechanics. Now we come to the question of what happens if I switch on more than two. See, remember I first went in this axis, then in this axis, then in this axis. But suppose I switch on two axes simultaneously. That is, I switch on the speed of light and I also switch on gravity. Then I am essentially combining the principles of special relativity, which comes along this direction, and principles of gravity, which come along this direction. That leads to probably the most beautiful of all physical theories we have today, called the general theory of relativity, which was created exactly, 99 years back. So 2015 is the anniversary of the creation of general theory of relativity by Einstein. What it tells you is something quite fantastic. I said that special theory of relativity puts together space and time into a single fabric we call space-time. What this tells you is that the gravity is nothing but the curvature of the space-time. Suppose you think of this as some kind of a caricature of space-time. And if there is a massive body here, it sort of curves it. It is like, putting a ball in a mattress. It sort of curves it, and if you keep another ball here, it will roll down here. And if you didn't know the curved mattress, you will think that there is a force of attraction between the two. So the gravitational force arises as due to the curved space-time. And there is a very simple law which tells you how curved the space is compared to how much energy you keep there. The more energy you keep in a place, and remember that E equals mc square, so energy is same as mass, the more energy you keep in a place, the more curved it will be. Okay? The way you think about this is, if I have a straight rod, it is not curved at all. Suppose I gently turn it, then it has a small curvature. If I twist it a lot more, then it will be very curved. So you can draw a circle here and look at its radius. The smaller the radius, the more curved that metal is. So there is an inverse relation between the radius of curvature. If I put a sphere here and see, measure its curvature, that radius of curvature, and the amount of density, energy density which is present. The more energy I put in some place, the sharper the curvature. This equation incidentally happens to be exact with the proper interpretation, and this is what the theory of relativity tells you. Now the reason I spend so much of time on this is that we are going to talk about cosmology, and the expanding universe is a creation from the theory of relativity. The proper way to understand the expansion of the universe is by saying that if the universe is curved with some radius of curvature, then it will double its size in a time scale which is that radius divided by speed of light. So the universe will double its size in a time scale which in turn is related to this curvature, which in turn is related to the amount of energy there is. So when the universe was very young, it was, say it was 1 second old, it was doubling its size every second. By now it has become very old and tired, and now it doubles its size only once in 14 billion years. So it slows down as it expands, and the doubling time also changes depending on the amount of curvature which is present. So I have now taken this and this direction. Let us go in a different direction. Let us take quantum mechanics and special relativity. That leads to what is known as quantum field theory. Many people have contributed to it. He is my favorite hero. It's a person called Dirac. The most important phenomena which comes up in quantum field theory is that what you think of as emptiness, nothing, or vacuum, is not a vacuum at all. It is milling with some activity. There are particles and antiparticles which are constantly produced and destroyed. There are fields which are fluctuating. And there is a huge amount of activity taking place in what you call vacuum. There is nothing which you can call really empty. And this is an artist's caricature of the vacuum fluctuations. It also predicts that for every particle you have in this universe, there is an antiparticle. We know that the normal matter is made of electron, proton, and neutron. Take electron for example. There is an antiparticle to electron, which is called positron, which has all the properties of the electron except that its charge is positive. Don't confuse it with proton, because it has only the mass of the electron. Now this might sound very esoteric, especially with a word like antiparticle, etc. But this is something which is used in various places. Some of you might have heard of something called PET, PET scan, which if you are unfortunate enough to end up in a hospital, they may do on you. The P in that PET scan stands for positron. So the positron, which is comes out as some esoteric particle from quantum field theory with this kind of a picture, is something which is used in medical diagnostic every day. It is created in the lab and it is used. So these antiparticles are one of the creations of the quantum field theory, and it is something which is a very, very important consequence of the quantum field theory. And then the standard model of particle physics, which we are all familiar with, and which uses to describe the microwave world, is also based on this. So we have done this, we have done this, and obviously the last thing you would like to do is to switch on all the three. Unfortunately, I don't have a photograph for that because this theory doesn't exist yet. So here is where you have switched on gravity, quantum mechanics, and relativity. And you should end up get a system which combines the principles of quantum mechanics and the principles of gravity. And we have not succeeded yet. And the later part of my talk, I will be talking about this quite a bit. So this is, as I say, is an unknown final. But fortunately or unfortunately, depending on your point of view, this is very much needed in cosmology. And I'll try to convince you that there are relics which we see in cosmology, relics which we see in the universe, which could be deeply connected with this quantum gravity, the quantum gravitational phenomenon. And that, as I said, will be in the last part of the talk. So, going back, I told you that there are two things cosmologists do. They use the laws of the structure of physical laws to understand the structure of the universe, or they use the structure of the universe to diagnose unknown physical laws. So the first part was using structure of the physical laws to understand the structure of the universe. So I have given you an orientation as to what the structure of physical laws are very rapidly. Now we want to look at the structure of the universe. That is the easy part, because this is nice, good, fun pictures and not equations. So let us look at that. So the simplest thing which you can look at in the universe is the neighborhood of Sun, the solar neighborhood. So here is Sun, here is Proxima Centauri, and these are a whole bunch of stars nearby. This is Sirius, and I'm sure many of you will recognize many of the stars which is written down. So the length scale here is like 10 light years. Go a bit further. Now the length scale you are talking about is like 1,000 light years. And this is your solar neighborhood, and you can still recognize some of the stars like Betelgeuse and things like that. And you sort of see some structure here. If you want to see it in full glory, you go one step further. And this is our galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy, with its beautiful spiral structure. And each of these arms are named after well-known constellations in the sky. So here is a nearby dwarf galaxy. And now you are talking about 10,000 light years in this length scale. Go a bit further. Now the entire Milky Way is confined here. And the nearest large galaxy is the Andromeda galaxy, which is just about visible to binoculars. And this distance now is about 1 million light years. And there are large number of, these dots now are not stars, these dots now are each is a galaxy, dwarf galaxies. And this whole thing together is called the local group of galaxies. So here, I mean, up to this point was artist's caricature, but fairly accurate caricature. This is a real photograph of the Andromeda galaxy, which is the nearest large galaxy to us. And we have a host of them. There's a zoo of galaxies. These are all photographs of galaxies. They come in all sizes, shapes, colors, what have you. And in fact, we understand most of them. Now, as far as cosmologists are concerned, we guys don't look at anything which is smaller than a galaxy. We don't care. So our world begins at galaxies. And in some sense, it is like condensed matter physicists who will not look at anything smaller than an atom. They will start with the atoms and build lattices and matter and things like that. But anything smaller than an atom is not their department. So similarly, anything smaller than a galaxy is not my department. So let us start by asking how these galaxies are distributed in the universe. And that is again fantastic. So here is a picture. So we are somewhere over here. And you find that all these things which are here, these filamentary structures and these voids, etc. These are all sort of shaped by the distribution of galaxies. The galaxies are distributed not at random. Okay, there are clearly patterns here. There are voids and filaments and shapes. They are not definitely distributed like a regular cube either. So it is not very regular, it is not completely random. It is somewhere in between. And it contains tremendous amount of information. If you only had eyes to see the galaxies, I mean, poets keep writing about star-studded skies. That is because poets don't know about galaxies. The galaxy-studded sky would look like this. If you really had eyes to detect galaxies, this is made out of a mosaic of real photographs. Okay? This is how the night sky will look. All the stars have been taken out. Every dot in this is a galaxy. And there is over a million galaxies here. And obviously, since it's a real picture, there are regions where we don't have data, which are in gaps. And you can again see patterns there. There are regions where, you know, there are streams of galaxies. And there are regions where it is under. So if you project it in some kind of a three-dimensional rotation, this is how it will look like. So we are somewhere out here. And when you go radially out, we are going further and further. And any one of these is like an angular direction. And the third angular direction has sort of skewed. So it's like a slice of pizza. So again, you can see these are regions which are very dense. And there are regions where there are virtually no galaxies. And they are distributed in some kind of. Very fascinating. So we want to understand, starting from this, at least two questions arise. First is that, how much matter is out there? There are so many galaxies. I talk in billions and billions. So how much matter is really there in the universe? And how did it form? How did such fantastic structures form? Where did it come from? Okay. So these are the two questions we want to ask. So when I ask how much matter is out there in the universe, I'm talking in terms of densities. That is, you take all the galaxies and distribute it smoothly. How many atoms will I get per cubic centimeter? Okay, that is the kind of question which one is asking. And then how did it assemble itself into such beautiful patterns? That is the second question. Okay, so let us start with the first one. We want to measure how much matter is there in the universe. And the cosmologists like to talk about it in terms of a parameter denoted by the Greek letter omega, which essentially measures the relative strength between how fast the universe is expanding and how much gravity is there which is pulling it back, so to speak. So the omega, it is arranged in such a way that you can easily remember omega equals 1 means that these two are perfectly balanced. If a universe has omega greater than 1, it means it will expand to a maximum size and recollapse it. If omega is less than 1, it will keep expanding forever. And omega equals 1 is a theoretically very significant ballpark number, and that is the one where it just balances on it. So we want to measure how much is this omega. We know how fast the universe is expanding. That can be measured very accurately. So if I know how much matter is there, then I can construct omega. Well, that is very easy. I showed you such beautiful pictures of all the galaxies. You just count all of them. You determine how much mass is there per galaxy, and then you add them all up. I mean, it's a lot of work, but what are graduate students for? So you can make them do this, and they will get their PhD on the side, and you can give talks about what the answer is. So if you do this with just visible matter, just what you can see, what emits light, then you get an answer that omega is typically like 5%. Okay? So it is like 0.05. So it's well below what is needed to make the universe reach a maximum radius and collapse back. But that is what you get by looking at all the visible matter in the universe. So the first question you want to ask is, well, is there more things in this universe than that meets your eye? And it turns out that this is actually true. I mean, there is a lot of matter in the universe which does not emit any form of electromagnetic radiation. So how do we know that? Well, there are various ways of doing it. Even though it doesn't directly emit radiation, there are effects which are visible to you. So let me give you two examples. So here is the first example. This is a visible galaxy, and this is the visible matter. Here is where it is distributed. Fortunately for us, there are tiny hydrogen clouds, like dust particles, which orbit around the galaxy. And you can measure with what speed that is orbiting. So just as if you know the speed with which a planet is orbiting the sun, and you know the distance of that planet from the sun, you can figure out what is the mass of the sun, is 800 physics. So you can actually do that. In the same sort of way, if you know with what speed this hydrogen cloud is orbiting around, which we can measure, and how far away it is, then you know how much matter is inside. So people did that. So they plot the speed with which it is orbiting against the distance from the center. If all the matter is what you see, then you expect to see a curve which goes like this. What you observe is something like this. So that tells you that there is this much of gap everywhere, and that is filled by matter which is not emitting light. This is what is called the dark matter. So there is so much of dark matter around it, and this is sort of embedded in the dark matter hat. I'll give you one more example. So this is a picture of a whole lot of galaxies. And you can easily convince yourself that there are arc-like structures. There are even sort of circular arcs here. But you see lots of these arcs. What are these? These are genuine galaxies, which are not arc-like in shape at all. These are genuine elliptical or spherical kind of galaxies. Very far away, the light from which is coming towards you through a cluster of galaxies, which are nearby. So there is a faraway galaxies, and the light from that is coming to you through a nearby cluster of galaxies. And this nearby cluster of galaxies bends the light. I mean, that is one thing which happens in Einstein's theory. The light gets bent, and it also gets distorted. This is what people call a gravitational lens, but it's a bad lens in the sense that it distorts the images. And it makes nice elliptical shaped images into these arc-like structures. And how much of this arc-like structure gets formed depends on how much of matter is there to distort it. So by making careful measurements of these arc-like structures, you can figure out how much of matter is there. And you can compare it with how much of visible matter is there. And this is a very powerful test, because anything which is gravitating is going to bend the light, and anything that is gravitating is going to act as a gravitational lens. So you measure something which is a lot more than what is visible. When you do all this, the bottom line is that the dark matter contributes about 25%. So you have got about 5% of normal matter, 25% of dark matter. Well, we are getting there, but it is still 30%. So let us stop there for the moment, and I'll get to the 70% later on. Okay, so what does this tell you about the universe? So this is a very simple way of presenting that result, and don't worry too much about what this graph represents. Essentially, it is telling you that the density of the normal matter keeps coming down as the universe expands. When the size of the universe increases, it drops. Okay. Now, there is also dark matter, which is typically, 5% and 25%, which is like 5 times or whatever. At any given size of the universe, there is a lot more dark matter than normal matter. And that also sort of drops as the universe expands. These are the two constants I have talked about. Are these the all? No, we have missed one very important component. There is radiation. There is huge amount of radiation in the universe. But the most important among them for cosmology is what is known as cosmic microwave background radiation. So if you think of this yellow border here as a microwave oven, and your universe is kept inside, that is how the universe behaves. The universe behaves as though it is kept inside a microwave oven, that dabba, which is kept at a temperature 2.73 Kelvin. Okay. So everywhere it is filled with radiation corresponding to this temperature. After all, this microwave oven, that is exactly how it heats up stuff which you keep inside. There is radiation filling that box. In fact, if only you had a bad TV, bad old-fashioned TV with this kind of antenna and no noise reduction, then when you are tuning between two stations, about 1% of the specks you see in the TV is direct interaction with the Big Bang universe. This radiation I told you is coming to you from the very early phase of the universe. It is coming towards you from a time when the universe was 1,000 times smaller than the current size. And that is the time when the universe was very hot, it was filled with this radiation, and that radiation decoupled from matter at that time, it is flowing towards you, which you can catch in your TV provided it's bad enough. So you have radiation, and the energy density of the radiation, shown in blue, falls faster than the matter. So matter energy densities come like this, and the radiation comes like this. So today the radiation energy density is much smaller than the other energy densities. But as you go into the fast, it will cut this, and in very early universe, the radiation is the most dominant thing in the universe. The reason I drew this picture is because I want to tell you something important. There is a point in time when the amount of radiation energy which was present in the universe was equal to the amount of energy density contributed by matter. Actually dark matter, but that doesn't matter. So this energy density I have indicated by a number. So this rho is a Greek symbol, and EQ is for equality. This is a pure number. You can measure it, and we have measured it. We know how much it is. So this is the first number which I'm introducing, which characterizes the universe. Eventually, I want to tell you that our universe is completely described by three numbers, three densities. So this is the first amount. Okay? So let us keep that in mind and proceed further. I told you there are two questions. One question was how much matter is out there in the universe, and I have now given you a catalog of all kinds of matter. The second question was, how did this form? How did all these things come into being? Okay, that is very easy, because all that you have to do is to make a universe. Then you will know how it came into being. So let us make a universe, assuming this works. Well, let us see. Just give me a second. There you are. So what you are seeing here is small, tiny, density inhomogeneous in the universe, which is condensing out due to its own gravity and sort of forming the kind of structure which you see. With a little bit of imagination, you can think of each one of them as a galaxy, and there are voids, filaments, structures, and all these things. So you start from, let me try my luck once again. Yeah. So it starts with some very tiny, teeny density and homogeneity, and as time goes on, the gravity enhances them, and you form structures. So what it tells you, first of all, it tells you that you need good computers. And the second thing which tells you is that if you have tiny perturbations in the universe, the density is large at some place and small at some other place, then if you let gravity act on it, you can form the kind of universes which you see here. That is fine in a computer, but is this the way the real universe gets formed? So can we really test this idea observationally? Is there a good test of this idea? Well, the key point here is that if this idea has to work, then somebody has to give you small fluctuations. So there has to be some amount of density in one place should be slightly more than the density at another place. Then you let gravity on it, and then the gravity will do the rest, and it will form the universe for you, so to speak. But did we really have, if the universe was completely smooth, none of this will occur. So was there small fluctuations in the universe sufficiently early? You can test this, because one idea which will keep coming up is that if you are looking at very far away distances in the universe, then you are actually looking at the universe as it was earlier on. Because when I look at any one of you, I'm not seeing you as you are right now. I'm seeing you as you were a tiny fraction of the second earlier, because light takes some amount of time to come from you to me. When I'm looking at the sun, I'm looking at the sun as it was 8 minutes earlier. So if you can look sufficiently further away, then you can see the universe as it was very early on. And people can actually see the universe as it was 1,000 times smaller. So here is where this 2.73 Kelvin radiation I told you came from. But when I told you that, I simplified it a little bit. I said it's a very uniform radiation like this. Well, it's not quite. You find that there are tiny specks, in the sense that there are regions which are hotter and there are regions which are colder. So this is the actual map of this cosmic microwave background radiation. What it tells you is that if you look at two different directions in the sky, the temperature is not 2.73 here and 2.73 here, it differs slightly. How slightly? Few parts in a million. But technology has made us, has helped us to make this kind of maps. This is really beautiful, because all these tiny wiggles in this is a gold mine of information, and you can do a lot with it. In fact, just to emphasize the role of technology, here is how this area progressed. This is the picture in 1992. Nearly 10 years later, this is what we had. Another 10 years later, this is the picture which we have, and things are getting better. So this is the kind of resolution which we have been able to achieve in a 20-year span. And using this, we can do lots and lots of modeling. So I know that this is a public lecture, so I don't want to show too many graphs or explain things. But there is just one point I want to make on this graph. It doesn't matter what this graph shows. Just forget it. Actually, it shows what is the kind of temperature difference at a given angular scale. So if you take 0.2 degrees away, take two points which are differing by 0.2 degrees. Take the temperature here, subtract it, and then average it over the sky, the RMS fluctuation in that. At 0.2 degrees, this is the RMS fluctuation. But what I want you to understand is the following. You can make these measurements, and these measurements are shown by these data, the tiny red dots here. Then you see a blue curve there. That is a theoretical prediction. So you have an exquisitely fitting theory to the data. That is, we can understand the observations which are given by this. It has all kinds of structures in it. We can understand it theoretically. And there's a particular theoretical model which fits it. And I need to explain to you what that model is. So you only have to understand that there is experimental observation and there is theory, and they fit very, very beautifully. Now the question which will immediately come here is that this temperature difference in the two parts in the sky is because the density at these two parts in the sky was different. Because that is how I motivated it. I said if there is some tiny fluctuation, then gravity will act on it and produce for you the universe you see. But that is just pushing the ignorant one step further. Now you will ask, where did these fluctuations come from? And these fluctuations seem to have a very characteristic signature. Where did this come from? Can we understand that? Second, suppose I do give you these fluctuations, does it lead to exactly the kind of structures which we see? So there are two parts to this. So this is in the center. The answer to the first part is that what I told you right at the beginning. The vacuum fluctuations in the very early universe, at the very early universe when you thought there was nothing, there was vacuum fluctuations. And these vacuum fluctuations can lead exactly to the kind of fluctuations you see in the sky when the universe was 1,000 times smaller. Second, you can grow it by gravitational processes and lead to the kind of galaxies you see. So there are two parts to this, and I want to talk to you about both parts. So let us start with this part. So we want to first understand, where did this come from? When the universe was 1,000th of its size, it had fluctuations, and I'm telling you that these fluctuations came from the vacuum fluctuations in the very early universe. This can be done, but it requires a very specific kind of behavior of the universe very early. And this is known as the inflationary phase of the universe. Okay, that was a very leading research area for the last several decades. I told you that let me introduce that concept. I told you that there is this energy density or the matter density of the universe which is made of radiation and dark matter. And together it had a behavior like this. Now I am telling you that very early on, somewhere out here, there is an inflationary phase to the universe. So how did that inflationary phase behave? Inflationary phase is characterized by a very simple behavior. The density at that time is constant. Okay. If the density is constant, as I told you, the radius of curvature of the universe is a constant. If the radius of curvature is constant, it doubles itself at the same time scale. It's something like your national savings certificate, which doubles every once in, say, 8 years. Okay? So this kind of a growth is what physicists call exponential. Because if you just leave it alone for a long period of time, it will have a very high cumulative effect. So this is the time when the size of the universe is increasing exponentially, because it is doubling at every constant time, and the density remains constant. What you want to understand is that these kinds of fluctuations which we see here observationally implies and is most naturally explained by saying that there was an inflationary phase in this universe. Now what it tells you for our purpose is that there is a second number. There is a density at this time, which I denote by rho, inflation. Remember, I gave you another density here, which is the density of the universe when these two things were equal. So I have got you two numbers. There is just one more left. So the universe is completely characterized by three densities. So this is the first one, and this is the second. This is the inflationary phase of the universe. Okay. How do we know what these densities are? Of course, we can measure them to some extent, in some kind of a model way, by modeling them. But we believe that the high energy physics eventually will, in principle, determine the values of these two. This can certainly be described from high energy physics, high energy particle physics, because that is what will tell you what the dark matter is. And this rho inflation can also come from high energy particle physics. So there is no real mystery there. It is still in the history phase of the universe. Remember the title of the talk. Okay, so we believe that these two things can come from this, but there are these two. Okay. Now let me come to the last part. So you started from vacuum fluctuations, produced these, and then you want to have gravity act on it and produce the kind of structures you see today. This you can do, but it depends on the nature and amount of matter in the universe. Or rather, you make different kinds of composition for the universe, start with this and run it through, and you will end up with different kinds of universes here. It's all very closely tied. So by looking at this, you can actually measure what is the composition of the universe. When people did this, they were in for a deep surprise. They found that the universe has a very strange composition. I had already told you nearly 5% of it is made of normal matter. There is about 25% or so which is made of dark matter. It turns out that this remaining nearly 70% or 71% is made of something which is essentially, effectively, a term in Einstein's equation called cosmological constant. It's a pure number. Now, this is what used to be called dark energy. That sort of makes you think in terms of Star Wars, Dark Vader, mysterious things, you know, Prapancham, early universe, Vedas. So we don't want any of that. So I'm just going to call it cosmological constant. Because all the observations which we know of today agrees if you just say that what this is made of is cosmological constant. So you have three things, cosmological constant, atoms, and dark matter. And this observation can be completely explained by this. And this is what the universe is made of. Okay? How do I know that? Again, what observation can directly tell you that there is this 75% made of cosmological constant? It is actually possible because this cosmological constant has a very peculiar behavior that it can accelerate the expansion of the universe. The universe is expanding and you ask whether it is expanding faster or slower. And if the expansion of the universe itself is becoming faster and faster, it is accelerating. And the cosmological constant will do this. So this can be directly measured. In the same philosophy again, I told you that if you are looking further and further, you are looking at the universe earlier on. So you measure how fast the universe was expanding yesterday and how fast it is expanding today, and you compare them. Then you know whether it is expanding at a faster rate today compared to yesterday or not. Except that you can't do it with yesterday, you have to do it with a few billion years. Now the only trouble with this idea is that you have to see further and further. And when you are looking further and further, the things become dimmer and dimmer. So if you want to catch them, you need some very bright object. And you need high resolution. Fortunately, the nature has given us a very bright category of object called supernovas. These are the end stages of stellar explosion. And this particular residue which I am showing there is what is known as the Crab Nebula. This is the relic of a supernova explosion which took place in our galaxy in 1056. And it was such a spectacular event that, for example, ancient Chinese astronomers, I'm sure all of you know Chinese, recorded it in this scroll. Okay. And it was also noticed by some of the early Red Indian tribes in North America. It's a bit strange. 1056, that period is the peak of Chola Empire in South India. We have absolutely no record of this. Okay? So the sort of charitable interpretation is it happened on July 4th and it must have been pretty bad monsoon. But this thing was visible to naked eye for nearly 4 months, 5 months, depending on your eyesight. And it was 8 times brighter than Venus at its peak. So it is still a little bit mysterious that nobody in high civilization in Chola Empire, for example, did this. But there are these supernova explosions. And using these as candles, you can measure out how the universe was expanding earlier on. And these are all, each of these data points come from a supernova. Now we can measure them very far away. And this is what it tells you. So what does it tell you? It tells you the speed of expansion of the universe as a function of the size of the universe. So you see that the speed of expansion was coming down, coming down, coming down, turning around, and it is increasing. So here the speed was decreasing, so the universe was decelerating. Here the speed is increasing, the universe is accelerating. Okay? So I mean, it's very obvious from this picture. So this, of course, was done by several people, but this way of presenting the data is due to Tirthankar Roy Chaudhary, who is a faculty at NCRA here, and myself. So you have this accelerating phase of the universe, so we have a direct evidence that the universe is indeed accelerating. And there is indirect evidence from the cosmic microwave background radiation that there is a cosmological constant which is doing this. If this is indeed the case, you can then go and plot the cosmic density. Again, you can observe it. and how the density of the universe is changing with time as the universe is expanding. If the universe keeps expanding, you would expect the density to keep decreasing. No, that is not what is happening. It flattens out to a constant level. This value is determined by the cosmological constant, this parameter you have thought. There is a bottom line below which the universe's density doesn't decrease. This is the what I call the cosmological constant so far. As I said, it is just a term in Einstein's equation which acts like matter with negative pressure. That is what accelerates the universe. And in some sense, virtually every theoretical physics thinks that understanding this is the most important aspect of theoretical physics today. We don't have a clue as to what is this quantity, which sort of constitutes 75% of the universe and is driving the accelerated expansion of the universe. So let us go back to this diagram again. So this is the first diagram I showed you with the equality. If there is a cosmological constant, the density doesn't keep dropping. It comes to a plateau and just stays put here. So now you have the equality, rho equality, then another constant density here. This is another parameter. So if you put them all together, you now have the three numbers. Our universe, the actual mathematical equation describing the expansion of the universe, can be written down once you give me these three numbers. So there are three densities in the universe, which characterizes its entire dynamics, its entire history. So first of them is the density during the inflationary phase. The second is the density at the time matter and radiation had the equal value. And the third is the cosmological constant in this kind. But remember that I told you we have a hope of understanding this and this from high energy physics. We have absolutely no idea what this one is. So this total cosmic density is like this with all the three, but we do not know what the cosmological constant is. So let me try to spend a little bit of time. Why is it that people think it is mysterious. So just like it is a density, you can also think in terms of length scales. And the cosmological constant can be denoted by a number, which has the dimensions of 1 by length square. Now you multiply it by three fundamental constants, which we saw way back in our first slide, the G, H cross, and C. So you are now combining together gravity, quantum theory, relativity and the cosmological constant. This happens to have the dimensions of square of the length. This has the dimensions of inverse square of the length. So the product of this is a pure number. This is a mysterious number which characterizes our universe. Our universe has all these constants. Okay? So it is nice to know what this number is. This number happens to be 10 to the power minus 123. Just for the sake of those of you who are not mathematically inclined to have stumbled into this talk, this notation means that you are taking like 1 by 10, 1 by 100, 1 by 1,000, 1 by 10,000. You take 1 divided by a number which is made of 1 followed by 123 zeros. Okay? So 1 by 10,000 has 4 zeros. So you take a number which has 1 followed by 123 zeros and you take 1 by that. So this is such an extremely tiny number and is one of the precisely measured numbers in cosmology. This is what observations tell you, and theory doesn't have a clue what it is. And this is why this is a mystery. You take fundamental constants of nature and together you get a number like this, and you need to understand this number. And that is the puzzle. Now people have looked at it. Many people have many ideas about it. And there are equivalent ways of doing this. But as far as the last part of the talk, I'm going to talk about our own work on this subject. And our own work can be best summarized by this. I mean, lots of people have tried to solve the cosmological constant problem. But in my opinion, this is very well epitomized by this line. In case you guys haven't read this book, you should go and read it. It's a very nice book. So the most of the work in this field was attacking it in the wrong direction. The way they were thinking about this is that we have this cosmological constant lambda, and we want to understand its value, so let us look at it very, very, very carefully, and then we will know what its value is. That is not the way it works. The real problem with lambda is not a problem with lambda at all, it has to do with gravity. So I want to explain to you why it's a problem with gravity. The easiest way to understand this is that the way you think of gravity today, in standard Einstein's theory, it seems to be immune to shifting of the energies. Okay? So what do I mean by that? Let me try to give it to you graphically. So here is the cosmological constant, which is some energy density in the universe. Now suppose this energy density changes due to some process. It shifted from here to here. Okay? Or suppose it went down. Okay, in any way. This has happened during the evolution of the universe because of various processes which I don't want to go into. This has changed. But there is no trace of that in the cosmic evolution. So we understand this by saying that the gravity is actually immune to these energy shifts. But this is not consistent with Einstein's theory. In standard Einstein's theory, this doesn't happen. So you have to tinker with Einstein's theory in some way. It is telling us something about Einstein's theory which is wrong. In the sense that in standard Einstein's theory, it is not immune to energy shifts. Universe went through these energy shifts and we don't see traces. That is part of the problem. The second part is, after it does all that, it finally settles down to a zero level of energy. And we want to understand that number, that 110 to the power 120. So this is either a large or a small number, depending on whether you take this ratio or an inverse ratio. And we need to attack both these things. So for this, many of us believe that you need a completely new perspective, and the conventional Einstein theory cannot explain. So this new perspective, which people have been working on, essentially tells you that gravity could be what people call an emergent phenomenon. So I want to describe to you in the last part of the talk what an emergent phenomenon is and how that ties in with what we are thinking. So it might sound like a big word, emergent phenomena, but you're all familiar with it. The normal gas dynamics, the ideal gas equation, is an emergent phenomenon. When you talk about gases and how gases behave, you don't really need to worry about what it is made of. The fact that it is made of molecules, etc., came much later. People could write down laws of gas dynamics even before that. For example, many of you will be familiar with this equation called the ideal gas law, which says PV is equal to RT. And the fact that where the pressure comes from, where the volume comes from, etc., is irrelevant to this equation. So you can describe a theory like this, and the dynamics is completely independent of the microstructures which is going on. So the claim is that the gravity as we understand it is in some sense the fluid mechanics of some unknown atoms of space-time. Just as if you look at a fluid, if you look at a bottle of water, it looks like a very smooth object. Okay, there is smooth flowing water. But we know that it is made of zillions of molecules which are moving around with empty space in between. No one looking at this will tell you that there are tiny empty spaces between the molecules, but we know it is a fact. In the same way, space-time looks to us like a continuum. I can wave my hand through it, but there could be atoms of space-time, and the gravity could be a limiting behavior, just as I can describe the behavior of this fluid using laws of fluid mechanics without knowing what the molecules are. I can describe the behavior of gravity in Einstein's theory, but there is an underlying deeper theory. So what it suggests is that we should study gravity exactly the way physicists have been studying the gas dynamics before they came to know of the atomic structure of matter. Today we don't understand the atomic structure of space-time, but it doesn't matter. Just as we could understand this, we can understand the structure of space-time. The real problem again has to do with technology and the scales. So let me illustrate that. Here is a picture with both macro world and micro world. On the y-axis, I'm going in powers of 10, 10, 100, 1000, 10,000 like that. Here I have gone to 1 followed by 10 zeros, 1 followed by 20 zeros like that. So if you go up to this point, you are reaching the edge of observed universe, so to speak. If you go the same way in the microscopic scale, 1 by 10, 1 by 100, 1 by 1000, 1 by 10,000, the experimental results in the lab stop somewhere here. We have gone only up to this point. If you take every theoretician on his face value, we do have theoretical model, you can go up to this because there are some things called grand unified theories which most people believe in. You are still not reached the edge of the universe in this direction. But what is more fascinating is that the kind of scales which I am talking about, where the atoms of space-time will be visible, is somewhere here. So in order to detect this, you have to go further away in microphysics. Then you have to go from your everyday scale to the edge of the universe. It is, in so to speak, beyond the edge of the universe in the microscales. So that is why it is extremely difficult to say something concrete about this, which can be tested in the observation. Your only hope is cosmology. Because the cosmology requires these energy scales and can leave residues from these energy scales for you to measure. So when you do this emergent gravity paradigm, what you find, the key results are something like this. The Einstein's equations turn out to be like equations of gas dynamics. And most importantly, in this theory, gravity is immune to energy change. I told you that we have evidence that the universe as it went through, the constant energy, which I told you, the cosmological constant, its value changed. But it has left no trace, which means that the gravity must be immune to this adding or subtracting of the zero point level of the energy. In conventional Einstein theory, this is not true. But when you look at it from the emergent gravity paradigm, this is the key difference. Gravity turns out to be immune to these energy shifts. And you can actually get more than what you put in. Just as if you have a gas and you keep it at standard temperature and pressure, the number of molecules in this is a constant. This is related to something called Avogadro's number. You can measure something like the Avogadro number for the space-time. And you can count how many atoms of space-time are there. You don't know what the atoms of space-time are. When people measured this, they didn't know what the gas is made of, so to speak. But they could count it. They could count something. They didn't know what they were counting. In the same way, we can count, and you'll find that 1 square centimeter of any area contains 10 to the power 66 atoms of space-time. Okay? So this is a measure which you can develop using these ideas. And there is also a nice way of this, I will escape, this is slightly technical. But what it tells, okay, let me just describe it briefly, because it is really fascinating. What it tells you is that the dynamics of the universe, so to speak, arises because of an interplay between these atoms of space-time and the normal atoms of matter. For example, take a three-dimensional volume, this is the surface in three-dimensional space, drawn in two-dimensional diagram. There are some number of atoms of space-time on this surface. I told you that 1 square centimeter of the surface has 10 to the 66, so if you give me the area, I know how many are there. Then there could be matter inside which is producing gravity, to which you can associate certain number of atoms. Actually, the technical term is degrees of freedom, but for a popular audience, atoms are good enough. So there are normal atoms here and atoms of space-time which you count here. And you find that this region expands or contracts or participates in dynamics if these two numbers are not the same. If these two numbers are not equal, something happens in between. If these two numbers are the same, nothing happens. It is stationary. So during the expansion of the universe, it turns out that both this phase and this phase, which was sort of steady constant curvature, had this equilibrium between the atoms of space-time on the surface and the normal atoms in the body, normal degrees of freedom. This happens here and this happens here, and in between it is not. And that is what caused this evolution from this scale to this scale. This has a bonus. When you take this idea a bit further, I told you that there are three densities here. This kind of describing the universe using these ideas gives you a relation between these three densities. This density and this density, some high energy physicist is going to give me eventually. But they have no clue where this comes from. But if I can give you a relation between these three, then I can determine all of them. In particular, this is the cosmological constant whose value we thought was very mysterious. And the formula which emerges out of this work is The third density, the dark horse, can be related to the other two densities by a formula. Again, for those of you who are not mathematically inclined, just imagine that there is a relation which tells you one of them out of the other two, thereby solving the problem about this row lambda. It gives you its numerical value. For those of you who understand the math, you can immediately see that this is an extremely tiny number. This is what leads to 10 to the minus 123. This is not 10 to the minus 123, but when you plug it in, this leads essentially to that 10 to the minus 123. So this is based on some work which I have done in collaboration with Hamsa, who is a research scholar at IUCAA. So this was last 2 years' work. And you do have a way of explaining this. Good, can we do better? Actually, you can. The point is that I told you that there are three densities. And these two, we have a theoretical understanding. This, we don't have a theoretical understanding. So that is why we are going to town saying that what you don't know, I can express in terms of what we know. But observationally, the situation is slightly different. Observationally, we know its numerical value very well. We know the numerical value of this very well. We don't understand it theoretically, but we know its numerical value. We know the theoretical value of this, numerical value of this from observation. Therefore, I can go back and calculate what in the inflationary phase the density would have. This theory makes a prediction. It tells you that at that time, the inflationary density has to be very tightly constrained, essentially between some 1.1 and 1.2 in some units. This is in the right ballpark figure. It could have been anything, but it comes out to be in the right ballpark figure. That was not by design. It is just telling you that the theory is right. Now tomorrow, if an observational evidence for inflation tells you that this is not correct, and it is off, there is a leeway of about factor 5 by doing various other complicated stuff, but not more than that. If that number is off by factor 10, this theory is wrong. It is there. So this theory actually sticks its neck out and makes a prediction which can be tested in future research. So that is a good place to sum up. So what I have been trying to tell you in the history part and the mystery part, the history part is easy. We do understand the evolution of the universe from a tiny fraction of a second, tiny, tiny fraction of a second, to 14 billion years. So if you don't want any speculations, this itself is very good, fantastic. And this is a good area to be working on. We also understand that the vacuum fluctuations generated during the early inflation of the universe can act as seeds for the cosmic structures like galaxies which we see today. So right from the beginning, when there is this vacuum fluctuation, that leads to the fluctuations in the cosmic microwave background radiation, which we have measured, and from the microwave background radiation by gravitational instability, we can form the kind of structures which we see. When you do this correctly, you end up noticing that there is a cosmological constant which contributes in nearly 70% of the energy density to it and is accelerating. And we need to understand this cosmological constant. This will require another paradigm shift. And I believe that the emergent gravity paradigm, which I described right at the end, is something which is explaining to you what the value of the cosmological constant is and why gravity behaves the way it is. Thank you very much.
So in this talk, we have come to know that to solve the mysteries of the universe, you don't have any CID. You need mathematicians and theoretical physicists. And I'm sure some of you are excited from this, and might take this up as a challenge in your life. Well, even if you don't, you might have some questions developing in your mind related to this talk. So we have a chance. We have a chance to interact with Professor Padmanabhan here. He has agreed to take a few questions. If you have any, please raise your hands. We'll come to you with a microphone. Please raise them high so we can see you. Okay. So.
Yes. Sir, it's a silly question. This dark energy, has it been constant right from the inflation period today?
Yes.
The total amount of energy.
Yes. The and okay. First of all, it is not dark energy. It is cosmological constant. Okay. So dark energy gives you all kinds of mysterious ideas which I want to avoid. So it is just a cosmological constant. It is a term in Einstein's equation. Being a term in Einstein's equations, it is constant too. Okay. There is no mystery about it. Yeah. Yes.
Is there any portion in the universe where light doesn't reach us? And if there's such a portion in the universe, then in that portion of the universe, Bohr's model of an atom will be true.
Bohr's model of an atom. Why?
Because in that portion of universe, light doesn't reach us. So Heisenberg's uncertainty principle will not work.
Why should uncertainty principle have anything to do with light reaching?
I was just inquiring that whether is there any place in the universe where light doesn't reach us?
No, because the part of the universe which we are talking about is something which we are observing by one ray or the other. So usually it is the electromagnetic radiation. But very soon we will have something which we call neutrino astronomy, where you can look at neutrinos which are reaching from some region to us and you can do astronomy with it. And we are very, very confident that we will have gravitational waves. So there could be gravitational waves coming from somewhere using which you can do astronomy. So the light is just one of the many carriers of information.
Speech was very impressive. I am a student of philosophy and with a high degree of knowledge in cosmology. Can you just in few words tell us if there is life existence elsewhere in the universe and is there any theory or something?
Yeah. Okay. So we do know that there are planetary systems around other stars. We have, if you just Google it, you will find that there's a catalog of exoplanets and there are. When I last looked at it, it was running into hundreds. So there are so many exoplanetary systems. These are like our solar system. So it is very, very unlikely that you will end up having Earth-like planets only around this tiny, weeny, non-discrete star which we call Sun. Okay, Sun is an extremely average kind of a star in the universe. So it is very likely that you will have Earth-like planets around other stars somewhere in the universe. If that is the case, it is extremely likely that there will be life forms elsewhere in the universe. I believe it is very likely that there will be life forms elsewhere in the universe. But having said that, it doesn't immediately lead to the kind of things Hollywood produces. So the reason has to do with the fact that if you look at the entire history of Earth, the life cycle of the Earth, the period of time in which the kind of civilization which we call ourselves belonging to, which is technologically advanced enough to send signals and receive signals, is a very tiny fraction of the entire lifetime of the Earth. So the fact that there will be some other planetary system which is going to exactly match us, so that we don't think of them like cockroaches and they don't think of us like cockroaches, is very, very important. So that is an extra probability factor. So my answer would be that it is very likely that life exists elsewhere in the universe, and it is very likely that it matters absolutely nothing to us.
So if I take a finite mass in a box,
yes,
and then I go on expanding, I would expect the density would go decreasing.
That's good.
But at current scale you are saying that it is flat. So it means that some extra mass is coming in or...
Okay. So good question. There are two ways of explaining that. The way I would explain it is what I have been saying. It is not really a density. It is only a term in Einstein's equation. Terms in Einstein's equation don't change because the universe is expanding. Okay, it is just a constant. That is why I kept calling it cosmological constant. It behaves like a density, but it is just a constant term. Therefore, it doesn't matter. Now, if you want a more physical interpretation, you can translate that term into a kind of a hypothetical fluid with negative pressure. Okay? So, as I said, it is just a way of thinking. If I have a balloon, just like you took a box and put mass in it, take a balloon and fill it with gas. If I expand the balloon, the density and the energy inside will come down. That is because the pressure of the gas is doing work on the surface of the balloon, and to do work its energy has to come down. But suppose it had negative pressure, then when it is doing work its energy will go up, or it can even maintain itself constant. So the cosmological constant, if you translate into like a fluid, it is a fluid with negative pressure. One of my transparencies had that line. So because of which it can remain constant even when the universe is expanding. But I wouldn't advocate thinking along those lines, because then people would start asking, can I put this negative pressure to technological use, and is it there in the laboratory? Can I collect it in a box, etc.? So if you think of it as a constant in Einstein's theory, then none of these questions are.
Sir, this is regarding the age of universe. Yes. I'm not sure, but I read it somewhere that age has been updated from 13.6 to something 14 plus. So firstly, how is this age calculated, and what is the significance of this in our physics? Does it help us in understanding it better? Does it affect our physics? And at last, can we theoretically calculate this, it will be somewhere between this and this, the age of universe?
Okay. So, it is very important to know this age precisely for various reasons. This age is related to what is known as the Hubble constant today, which is the rate at which the universe is expanding. Given the rate at which the universe is expanding and other parameters, you plug it into an equation and the age comes out. Now, observations have been continuously improving on the value of the Hubble constant. So probably what you are referring to must be that, because when the value of the Hubble constant was fixed properly by Hubble Space Telescope, the age also got revised. Okay. So that is one thing. Well, it is very important from another reason, because if you end up seeing something in the universe which is older than the universe, you are in a bit of a trouble. So there are star clusters whose age you can independently determine. And when the cosmologists, who don't usually talk to stellar physicists because it is subdialectic, but when they do meet in a conference and these two guys come with an age, and the stellar physicist age of a star cluster is larger than the age of the universe, we will have a conflict. This did happen at some stage in the history of the age of the universe, but it has been happily reconciled now. Today we do not have any object in the universe which is older than the universe. And the number was revised because of just technological measurements improved.
Hello sir, you have shown the graph of expanding universe. Early stages it is decreasing. So why is this happening? I heard that after Big Bang it's continuously expanding.
Yeah, okay, so I should have clarified it more. The universe is continuously expanding. What was decreasing and going up in that graph which I showed you? Yeah, this is the graph you are referring to, just to avoid anybody else's confusion. What is plotted here is not the size of the universe, but speed of expansion. Okay? Universe is continuously expanding, but its speed can decrease or increase. So think of a car. A car is continuously moving forward, but you can move the car with an acceleration forward, or you can gently reduce the speed. You are not reversing, you are still moving forward, but its speed can keep increasing or the speed can decrease. So at this point of the evolution, the universe is expanding, but its speed was coming down. At this point of the expansion, the universe is expanding, but its speed is going down. So the universe is continuously expanding since Big Bang, but its speed, we originally thought, was sort of, which was getting tired, but the cosmological constant has kicked it up and now it is high.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, we don't have enough time for all the questions. We know that all the mysteries of the universe cannot even be summed up in 1 hour, but Professor Padmanabhan has tried to do that for us. We thank him for that.